my Lord, perfect the earth. From him ecstatic praying,
our pastor of the devotees.
Oh, Master, please be merciful.
Text number one. Please repeat. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Text one, please repeat.
Shishuka uvacha.
Shishuka uvacha.
Dvaridyunandya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunandya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunandya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunandya rishabhakurunam.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Shatom pasritya chuta babasidha.
Shatom pasritya chuta babasidha.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Soshilya guna vitriptya.
Papracha soshilya guna vitriptya.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Papracha soshilya guna vitriptya.
Papracha soshilya guna vitriptya.
Please chant.
Shishuka uvacha.
Shishuka uvacha.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Dvaridyunadya rishabhakurunam.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Maitreyam asinam agadabodham.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Shatopasritya chuta bhavasiddha.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Papracha soshilya guna vitripta.
Shri Sukha Vacha.
Shri Sukha Vacha.
Dvari Dunaja Rishi Pakarunam.
Dvari Dunaja Rishi Pakarunam.
Maitreya Masina Magada Bodham.
Maitreya Masina Magada Bodham.
Shato Pasritya Tuta Pavasiha.
Shato Pasritya Tuta Pavasiha.
Papracha Sasiya Guna Vitrita.
Papracha Sasiya Guna Vitrita.
Shri Sukha Vacha.
Shri
Sukha Vacha.
Maitreya Masinam Agadabodham.
vikritta.
Papraca sasya aduna vikritta.
Word for word synonyms, please repeat.
Shri Shuka Uvacha.
Shri Shuka Uvacha.
Sukadeva Goswami says.
Sukadeva Goswami says.
Dwari.
Dwari.
At the source of.
At the source of.
Dhyunadya.
Dhyunadya.
The celestial river Ganges.
The celestial river Ganges.
Rishabha.
Rishabha.
The best of the Kurus.
The best of the Kurus.
Gurunam.
Gurunam.
Of the Kurus.
Of the Kurus.
Maitreyam.
Maitreyam.
Unto Maitreya.
Unto Maitreya.
Asinam.
Asinam.
Sitting.
Sitting.
Agadabodham.
Agadabodham.
Of unfathomed knowledge.
Of unfathomed knowledge.
Shatta.
Shatta.
Vidura.
Vidura.
Vasritya.
Vasritya.
Having approached nearer.
Having approached nearer.
Achyuta.
Achyuta.
The infallible Lord.
The infallible Lord.
Bhava.
Bhava.
Character.
Character.
Siddha.
Siddha.
Perfect.
Perfect.
Pacha.
Paparacha.
Inquired.
Inquired.
Soshilya.
Soshilya.
Gentleness.
Gentleness.
Guna apichittaha.
Guna apichittaha.
Satisfied in transcendental qualities.
Satisfied in transcendental qualities.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Shukadeva Goswami said, Vidura, the best amongst the Kuru dynasty, who was perfect in devotional service to the Lord, thus reached the source of the celestial Ganges River, Hardwar, where Maitreya, the great, fathomless, learned sage of the world, was seated. Vidura, who was perfect in gentleness and satisfied in transcendence, inquired from him. So previously we were hearing how Vidura was asking questions and hearing answers from Uddhava. And then Uddhava told Vidura that now I'm on my way to Badrik Ashram, so I will now defer to my elder, Maitreya, to continue answering questions for you. And he said he's just nearby, and he was here hearing from Krishna like I was, so he's just nearby. And we probably think, oh, he's just like behind that tree or something. But nearby is way over there. So Vidura traveled from the bank of the Yamuna to the source of the Ganges at Hardwar to inquire from Maitreya. Purport. Vidura was already perfect due to his unalloyed devotion to the infallible Lord. The Lord and the living entities are all qualitatively the same by nature, but the Lord is quantitatively much greater than any individual living entity. He is ever infallible, whereas the living entities are prone to fall under the illusory energy. Vidura had already surpassed the fallible nature of the living entity in conditional life due to his being Achyuta Bhava, or legitimately absorbed in the devotional service of the Lord. This stage of life is called Achyuta Bhava Siddha, or perfection by dint of devotional service. Anyone, therefore, who is absorbed in the devotional service of the Lord is a liberated soul and has all admirable qualities. The learned sage Maitreya was sitting in a solitary place on the bank of the Ganges at Hardwar. And Vidura, who was a perfect devotee of the Lord and possessed all good transcendental qualities, approached him for inquiry. And the Shiva Prabhupada's purport. So there's an important word in this verse, Achyuta Bhava Siddha. Achyuta means infallible, and that's another name for Krishna, because only he is infallible. So what does that mean, that Krishna is infallible?
He can't become an illusory energy.
Exactly. He doesn't make the mistake of falling under the illusory energy. So we're called fallible and he's called infallible. So achuta, and then bhava means like characteristic. It also means conception of. So this term, achuta bhava, first appears in the Bhagavatam in the first canto, where Narada Muni is giving instructions to Vyasadeva about his compiling the Srimad Bhagavatam. So Vyasadeva was compiling the Vedic literatures because he understood that in Kali Yuga, man is like so, the intelligence is going down, the memory is going down. We have to organize the shastras and we have to put it in writing, you know, because people need to see things in writing in Kali Yuga to get it, right? We have to read it like 50 times to get it through our head. So Vyasadeva took the great task of compiling the Vedic literature, culminating in the essential, most essential text, Srimad Bhagavatam. But after working on it, he didn't feel satisfied. So that's odd. Because when you do devotional service, if you're actually doing devotional service, the symptom is that you're satisfied. If you do your devotional service and you don't feel satisfied, you know, satisfied meaning pleased in your heart, then that means you're doing something wrong. So, yeah, so they felt like that. What am I doing wrong? I compiled the Bhagavatam and I don't even feel satisfied. So Narada Muni, being like the all-pervading super soul, he immediately appeared on the spot and chastised Vyasadeva. He said, you know what the problem is? You went through this big, big endeavor, compiling this whole literature, and you never got to the point of like glorifying Krishna's personal leela. You know, like Braj leela. You've given like a zillion verses about karma, kandiya, you know, and this, you know, jnana, and yoga, and meditation. You haven't gotten to the real nectar. And unless and until, so then he uses this term, achuta bhava. He says that path of self-realization, which is devoid of the conception, bhava, of achuta, the infallible Lord, doesn't look well. Doesn't matter what the knowledge is and what the karma, you know, karmic activity is, if it's devoid of the conception of achuta, then it's not very attractive. And it's not even really for the welfare of the people. So, you know, get back, you know, to your Bhagavatam and glorify the pastimes of Krishna. And that's why in the 10th canto we come to that culmination, or that pinnacle, I should say. So here in today's verse, Prabhupada is highlighting that term, achuta bhava siddha, which means Vidura was already perfected in his conception of achuta, of Krishna. There was nothing he didn't know. He was a perfect devotee. And what's the symptom that was pointed out here of a perfect devotee? They're gentle. I mean, there's many symptoms, but what was pointed out here today was highlighted the quality of being gentle and being completely satisfied in transcendence. Meaning, Krishna says in 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita that the real yogi is one who becomes satisfied in knowledge and realization. They don't need anything more. They're completely content with jnana vijnana chuptatma. Chupta means like satisfied. They become a self-satisfied person by dint of knowledge and realization. So here it's being highlighted that Vidura was already on that platform, completely satisfied in transcendence. That means no more doubts, no more anartas, you know, attacking him, like that. Yet we see very interestingly that he made the endeavor. It wasn't just like, you know, a 1 minute walk. He made the endeavor to walk from the bank of the Yamuna all the way to Haridwar, to the source of the Ganges River, just so he could meet Maitreya. And what did he do when he met Maitreya? He started to ask questions. And what were those questions? It wasn't about, hey, you know, like, how's the weather over here in Haridwar? Do you get many visitors here? What kind of fruit grows here? You know, nothing like that. You're going to start, in tomorrow's text, we're going to start getting into Vidura asking questions to Maitreya. And they're all about, guess who?
Krishna.
So this is the sign of an actually perfected devotee. That they might not have doubts. Like, we ask questions because we have doubts, you know. We're like, I don't know about that. Could you answer this question for me? And I have this doubt and that concern and this misgiving. That's why we ask questions, to be dispelled of our ignorance. But Vidura was not asking questions because he's in ignorance. Why was Vidura asking questions then?
The topics of Krishna can be discussed, and that's, it's in Bhagavad Gita, that's how one becomes pure devotees and live in each other by discussing.
Exactly. How are we going to talk about Krishna unless somebody asks a question? That's like a platform for discussion. So advanced devotees ask questions because, hey, give me the nectar, tell me what I want to hear. Even I already might know the answer, I want to hear it from your mouth. You talk about Krishna. And second, there's a second reason why great devotees ask questions. For the benefit of others. Yeah. You know, we're so self-absorbed, we only ask questions for ourselves. And actually, we're so proud, we don't even ask questions. Mm-hmm. I don't want to raise my hand and ask a question because everybody will know I'm a fool.
No, I know already. I know that one. That's why.
Or I'll be embarrassed. Maybe my question's dumb or something. But an advanced devotee asks questions, A, because they just love to keep hearing about Krishna. It's never stale. You can hear the same thing a billion times, and it's never stale. Why do we chant Hare Krishna? Are we actually bored chanting Hare Krishna, Abhimanyu? You've done it like how many times now already? Why do you do it every day?
Never
gets old. Yeah, and then why do you chant Coca-Cola, 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 Coca-Cola? See how long you last, right? So we have other examples of this in the Bhagavatam, of great devotees inquiring from other great devotees, and their inquiry, process of inquiry is glorified. So here, right at the beginning of the Bhagavatam, the very first chapter is called Questions by the Sages. So the sages of Naimasharanya have been blessed by Suta Goswami just by chance, wandering into their assembly. And when he gets there, they immediately practice the proper etiquette of receiving a great soul, and they offer him a seat of esteem, and they glorify him. And then what do? After they offer him a seat of esteem and glorify him, they start asking questions about Krishna. So, yeah, in the first chapter, that's your homework assignment. Go through the first chapter and find the questions by the sages. So, Suta Goswami, when they're done asking their questions, he thanks them for their question. And he says, Munaya sadhupishto ham bhavadvir lokamangalam yakrita krishna samprashna natma supasiditi. O sages, I have been justly questioned by you. Your questions are worthy. Why? What's the worth in them? Because they relate to Lord Krishna, and so are of relevance to the world's welfare. Only questions of this sort are capable of completely satisfying the self. Now, what have we all been subjected to for the last, you know, year, God knows how long? All questions about politics, economics, and you know, the politicians get together and they ask questions about how we're going to solve this problem and how we're going to solve that problem and how are we going to control the citizens, and it's just like endless, right? Who's satisfied by that? Have you been satisfied going on your computer or your phone and reading about all the political back and forth, back and forth, back and forth? Raise your hand.
Somebody would have a job. They're doing that.
Yeah, that's their.
I noticed that.
That's their so-called enjoyment. Mm-hmm. So what does Prabhupada say? That's also in the first canto, that those who are like swans, they enjoy crystal clear water and beautiful ponds that are decorated with lotus flowers. And those who are like crows, compared to people in the mode of ignorance, where do they go? They go to garbage pits. You know, I'm happy that here you don't have those black crows, you know? But like you go to the city like Chicago, and it's all you got is black crows all over the place. And all they're doing is going to the garbage. They live in, you know, they like the alleys. They go to the, you know, they're in the alleys of the cities, all these blackbirds, you know? And they're just in the alleys and they're pecking away at the garbage and the dog stool. I don't know what they do. They're just like filthy.
Unless they're like fall down bodies.
I'm sorry?
It's like fall down bodies.
Yeah. So Prabhupada does mention that no matter what species, not just human, there's different gradations according to the modes. So there's even dogs that are more in the mode of goodness and dogs that are more in the mode of passion and ignorance. I mean, animals are in the mode of ignorance, but some are have a little bit more of goodness to them, or, you know, like that. Anyway, so people who are like crows, they think they find satisfaction in questions and answers about all mundane subject matters. You know? Then we have another instance of, that was Sutta Goswami thanking the sages of Naimisharanya. But before they had their conversation, where is that? Okay. Before they had their conversation, Shukadeva Goswami had his conversation with Parikshit Maharaj. And Parikshit Maharaj also asked a very important question. What was that very important question, Prishni?
What should one do when one's about to die or leave his body? What should one think about? Or what?
Yeah. He said, what should a person, especially one who's on the verge of death, what should a person think about, speak about, hear about? And Shukadeva Goswami says to him, Varyanashate prashna krito loka hitam nipa atmavit samata pomsam shotavyadishtuya para. My dear king, your question is glorious, because it is very beneficial to all kinds of people. The answer to this question is the prime subject matter for hearing, and it is approved by all transcendentalists. So Shukadeva, Parikshit Maharaj was asking, what should we hear about? And Shukadeva Goswami says, the answer to your question is what we should hear about. Your question is so glorious. Why? What's so glorious about it? Because it's for the benefit of others. If you hadn't asked that question, we couldn't talk about what he's about to talk about, which is the whole Srimad Bhagavatam. So we should take lessons from these Achyuta Bhava Siddhas, those devotees who actually have perfected their realization of the conception of the Absolute Truth, which is Achyuta Sri Krishna, Bhagavan Sri Krishna. And what is their, you know, one of their main activities? Inquiring for the benefit of others. So this is the purpose of assembling together with devotees. We have devotees of all different levels and ages and realizations, especially when we have public programs like the Sunday program. Have you ever noticed, I've definitely noticed this, have you ever noticed that you're in a class like with, you know, public people, and you give a class and then you say, are there any questions? And nobody raises their hand. And you know, they come on, they don't know nothing about they don't ask a question. That's how dull people are. They can't even think of the question. Mm-hmm. How are you going to get an answer unless you ask a question? How are you going to ask a question unless you know what you're supposed to ask? Mm-hmm. It takes a little level of, you know. So when that happens and everybody's just sitting there, then it behooves that one of the devotees in the audience raise their hands and ask a question that they obviously know the answer to, but they want the audience to hear the answer to it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. For the benefit of others.
Get things started.
Yeah. Because you know they all have misconceptions. Are they Achyuta Bhava Siddha? Mm-hmm. Perfect in their conception of the Absolute? Of course they're not. So questions and answers. Mm-hmm. While you're out in the garden, while you're in the kitchen, wherever, questions and answers. Okay, we'll stop there, see if there's any discussion.
Now that you said it that way.
It's amazing you just said that way, because some people always said to me, and well, you're just addicted to these things, you just run over that, get that, do this, do that. I said, really? If somebody is not doing all this, then down the road there won't be somebody coming or appreciating. We all do these things for others, it's not for us.
Exactly.
This is what I always say. I don't know whether I said it right or wrong, but now you said like this.
If we're doing it for ourselves, we wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
We go get a job, they pay better.
Yes.
I mean,
yeah, you're right.
You know what I mean? And what did Prabhupada say? Vidura was already, he was absorbed in devotional service. Now, when Prabhupada translates the word bhakti, everybody translates the word bhakti as love and devotion. Prabhupada does not translate bhakti yoga as love and devotion. He translates it as loving devotional service. See, they all cut out the word service. They just put, oh, connecting with the divine through love and devotion. Right? There's a big bhakti yoga, in case you don't know it. There's a big bhakti yoga movement out there that has nothing to do with the Hare Krishna movement.
Mm, it's like Uttana Bhakti.
You know, like, yeah, like mundane, you know, Mayavadi type, really.
Yeah.
Ultimately, they're Mayavadis.
Yeah.
And they're all into like, yeah, it's bhakti yoga, it's love and devotion.
Yeah.
But where's the service? Mm. Who's the object of the love and devotion? And what does that mean? You're the object of my love. How do parents show their children that they love them? They serve them 24/7. And how ridiculous is it when a child says to the parents, I don't think you love me. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh yeah, right. I've been serving you 24/7 for how many years? And now you say, I don't think you love me. Because you know you got angry at me or something. Right? The proof of love is service. One time, Shuddha Kirti Prabhu accompanied Prabhupada, because he was his secretary and servant, you know, on his travels. So they arrived at some airport, and a whole bunch of devotees were at the airport welcoming Prabhupada, and they had this ecstatic kirtan. And the devotees were jumping up and down, tears were coming from their eyes, and it was just like ecstatic. The devotees just were overwhelmed seeing Prabhupada, many of them for the first time. Shuddha Kirti had been traveling with Prabhupada for how many hours and days? He was tired. He was carrying Prabhupada's luggage, just like this, through the airport. Then when they got to their destination, he said to Prabhupada, Prabhupada, I was just like, I saw all my godbrothers and godsisters jumping up and down in ecstasy when you arrived, and their love for you just overwhelmed me, and I realized I wasn't like that, and I guess I don't have love for you like they do. Prabhupada didn't say anything. And so Shuddha Kirti was like, oops, and he went away. Then later in the day, Prabhupada rang his bell. And Shuddha Kirti went into Prabhupada's room. Sit down. He said, do you like serving me? Yes, Prabhupada, of course I love serving you. That is love.
Yeah.
That's how you show your love. So Achyuta Bhava Siddha means that we're absorbed in devotional service. Yeah. Thank you. Anything else?
Well, that reminds me of a story of it was in Ramanujacharya. Ramanuja had two disciples. One was very wealthy, and the other was very poverty stricken. And the wealthy disciple, he went to visit him, and he was a good soul. He was very, you know, devoted. But he went to so much trouble to make so much arrangement for his Guru Dev to come, that when the servant of Ramanuja came and to come and tell him, "Oh, your Guru Dev is on his way," you know, let's prepare. They completely forgot to even notice the servant. The servant was exhausted from traveling. He was in need of food and water probably, but they just totally forgot about him.
Right.
And then Ramanuja chastised them later. Whereas the poor fellow, he was like, you know, immediately he served everybody, and it was a different experience.
Mm-hmm.
But the wealthy disciple, he was repentant, and he took it to heart.
Mm-hmm.
It was like a
Krishna,
disaster.
You know, gets glorified all the time.
It was just a set example.
Yeah.
Take care of the servants, not just the guru.
Right. Krishna gets glorified all the time, and Guru gets glorified all the time, but they're not actually satisfied with that.
Yeah,
they're satisfied when they see that you glorify their servants more than you glorify them.
And take care of them.
That's why we do Guru Puja every day, because Krishna's actually more pleased seeing us do Guru Puja than us doing his arti. Not that we shouldn't do his arti, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Not that we don't glorify Krishna. But he's actually really happy to see Prabhupada getting glorified.
There's one shloka in Sanskrit, Guru Bhavi Dono Khare Kako Lagu Pai Balihari Guru Apni Jamohe Govind Diyo Batai. It means Guru and Govind, Krishna, both are standing there. Who should I first bow down? I should bow down to my Guru because he is the one who took me to Krishna.
Mm-hmm.
So
and that, of course, presupposes that the guru is actually, you know, Vaishnava. Not all the gurus that are out there that aren't actually Vaishnavas, you know. Okay, anything else? Okay, thank you. We'll stop there. Ki